There will be peace in the valley for me. Well, I'm tired and so weary, but I must go along till the Lord comes and calls me away. As fair as the day, oh yes. There will be peace in the valley for me someday. There will be peace in the valley for me, oh Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow, no trouble I'll see. There will be peace in the valley for me. Well, the bear will be gentle and the wolf will be tame, and the lion shall lay down by the lamb, oh yes. Well, the beast from the wild shall be led by a child, and I'll be changed from this creature that I am, oh yes. There will be peace in the valley for me someday. There will be peace in the valley for me, oh Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow, no trouble I'll see. There will be peace in the valley for me.
In Matthew chapter 21, verses 12 and 13, we read about an occasion when Jesus cleansed the temple. Matthew writes, "Then Jesus went into the temple of God and drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he said to them, 'It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves.'" Jesus says that his house was to be a house of prayer. God's house is to be a house of prayer. And this means it is to be a house of spiritual benefits and not a place for making money. The money changers had made merchandise of religion. There was no one who knew more about prayer than Jesus did. And on various occasions, Jesus had spent entire nights in prayer. In fact, he spent all night in prayer, we read in Luke chapter 6, before he came down from the mountain the next morning and appointed from among his disciples 12, whom he appointed as his apostles. Christ's wrath against the money changers was bound up in the fact that they were not in the temple to honor God, but they were coming into his courts to use them as a springboard for their own material benefit. So what do we mean when we say that God's house is a house of prayer? What is prayer anyway? There are various words used in the New Testament that are translated by our English word prayer and it has other translations as well. The Greek word deomai, which means to want, to pray, or to beseech. Erotio, to ask or to interrogate. Eukamai, which means to pray or to wish. And pro-eukamai, which means to pray or to wish for. And I said there are other words too that are oftentimes translated prayer. But sometimes these words are translated ask or beseech. But a prayer, of course, is a word of either beseeching or a word of thanksgiving that we offer to God. We want to study a couple of lessons on the subject of prayer. And in this first lesson, we're going to talk about prayer as being praise and prayer as practicing the presence of God. And then in our next lesson, we'll talk about prayer as petition and prayer as potential. Jesus said that his house was going to be called a house of prayer, as we read in Matthew 21 and verse 13. You know, prayer, one of the aspects of prayer is that prayer is praise. And I want to turn over to the book of Revelation. In Revelation chapter 5 and verse 8, we read this scene from the pen of the Apostle John. Now, when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth." So in this scene of Revelation that John saw on the Isle of Patmos, he sees the elders and the Lamb there. And he says that the incense that they offer is the prayers of the saints. It's a metaphor here for the prayers of the saints. And there is this offering of prayer and praise to God because of what he has done. That the Lamb who had been slain and had redeemed all men who trust in him from all the people in every nation in the earth. But this was a demonstration of the praise of the people to God for his wonderful plan of salvation that he executed in Christ Jesus the Lord. Again in the book of Revelation, over in Revelation chapter 8 and down in verse 4, and let's read the first few verses just before that. "When he opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for almost half an hour. And I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. Then another angel, having a golden censer, came and stood at the altar. He was given much incense that he should offer it with the prayers of the saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints ascended before God from the angel's hand." And so in this scene that John sees and he records in the book of Revelation, he sees this angel who takes this incense again, or this censer, a golden censer, and he puts in it the incense, which again are the prayers of the saints that ascend up before God as a sweet-smelling savor before him. And so these two pictures we get from the book of Revelation show the prayers of the saints as being offered up before God, coming before him with his favor, and offering up the praise that we have for God because of what he has done for us in Christ Jesus. I want to look at just a few passages from the Psalms. And I'm going to start in Psalm 55 and verse 1. The Psalms, of course, are full of praise at times, and they're also full of complaints sometimes. But there is much of praise that we find in the petitions that men offer before God. In Psalm 55, in verse 1, the psalmist writes, "Give ear to my prayer, O God, and do not hide yourself from my supplications. Attend to me and hear me. I am restless in my complaint and moan noisily because of the voice of the enemy, because of the oppression of the wicked, for they bring down trouble upon me, and in wrath they hate me." So here the psalmist is asking God to hear his prayer that he offers up. And of course, he says that he has some complaint here. He wants God to hear his complaint, but there is also praise that is in these prayers that are made before God. Over in Psalm, the 66th Psalm, and verses 1 and 2, we read, "Make a joyful shout to God, all the earth. Sing out the honor of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your works. Through the greatness of your power, your enemies shall submit themselves to you. And all the earth shall worship you and sing praises to you. They shall sing praises to your name." And so here we have this psalmist picturing the praise that we offer God, again, because of the glorious things that he has done, but also because of just who he is and the fact that he is awesome and his creation is awesome. In the 64th Psalm, Psalm 64, and begin again in verse 1 of Psalm 64, the psalmist says, "Hear my voice, O God, in my meditation. Preserve my life from fear of the enemy. Hide me from the secret plots of the wicked, from the rebellion of the workers of iniquity." And of course, here is petition again before God, and we'll talk about petition a little later. But again, it begins with asking God to hear his voice. And we often offer up our praise to God for hearing us and listening to our petitions. In Psalm 65, verses 1 and 2, the psalmist writes, "Praise is awaiting you, O God, in Zion, and to you the vow shall be performed. O you who hear prayer, to you all flesh will come. Iniquities prevail against me. As for our transgressions, you will provide atonement for them." And so here the psalmist again talks about praising God, and he gets into this subject again of what God has done for us in Christ, providing atonement for our sins. And he says the fact that all flesh, that is all people, will come before him and will offer their praise to him. So one of the objects of prayer, of course, is to praise God, not only to petition him, but to praise him and to recognize God for who he is, because he is awesome. He is an awesome creator and one to whom praise is due. In the New Testament, over in the book of Hebrews, the 13th chapter of Hebrews, and in particular in verse 15 there, we may look at a couple of verses there though. In Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 15, we read, "Therefore by him," and that is by Christ, "let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God, that is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. But do not forget to do good and to share, for with such sacrifices God is well pleased." So he talks about two kinds of sacrifices here in these two verses, verse 15 and 16. And the first one is the fruit of our lips that we offer up to him in praise. We offer up by Christ to God continually praise before his throne. and we are not forgetful to do good works, because God is pleased with both kinds of sacrifices, both the sacrifice of the praise of our lips as we offer our thanks to Him, and also the good things that we do are well-pleasing sacrifices to God. In Hebrews, the 4th chapter, in verse 16, we turn to another aspect of prayer, and that is prayer is practicing and being in the presence of God. In fact, we want to read from Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. Of course, as we've noted, praise to God in prayer is both instructive and it is also comforting to us. It reminds us when we are offering our thanks and praise to God that God is on His throne and He is performing His will, and therefore all is well on the earth, despite all the lies that Satan may tell to the contrary and despite what others may say. We are reminded in praising God that He is in control and He is worthy of our thanksgiving and our praise. So we want to be in His presence then. In Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16, the Hebrew writer said, "Seeing then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot be or sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Here in Hebrews, we learn that when we go to God in prayer, we come into the very throne room of the King of the universe. We come into the presence of God in prayer. And Jesus is there making intercession for us. And so by Christ, we are in the presence of God when we go to God in prayer through our Lord Jesus Christ. So this is a part of our being present with God and God being present with us. The practice of prayer is to practice the presence of God in our lives and to be reminded that we are in His presence always. Whether we're literally offering up a prayer of our lips at a time, or whether it's just in our heart or in the lives that we live, we need to be practicing the presence of God. And God's presence is especially demonstrated when we go to Him in prayer. You know, to go to God and to come into His presence is to be reminded of God's power and His authority in our lives. And so we need to feel God's presence in our lives. And through prayer, we are enabled to recognize His authority and His right to reign and to rule in our hearts and in our lives. One of the things that we are relinquishing whenever we fail to go to God in prayer, we are relinquishing this feeling of God's presence in our lives, knowing that we are present before Him and that He is continually with us, and to be reminded of the fact that He does have authority in our lives. And so through prayer, we continue to recognize His presence in our lives. And we want His presence in our lives. We need Him. As the songwriter said, "Every hour I need Thee." And so we need God's presence in our life. So prayer is not just saying a few words or some kind of rote thing that we do, but rather prayer is the outpouring of our hearts before God. And in prayer, we do practice praise to God. Prayer is a means of praising God for His goodness and for His mercy, and reminding us of the fact that God has done so many wonderful things for us, and especially through Jesus our Lord. And then as we continue in prayer before God, we are reminded of His presence in our life as well as our presence before Him, that we are allowed to come into His very throne room through our high priest, Jesus Christ, who, as the Hebrew writer tells us, understands our situation because He lived in the flesh just as we are living. And He understands our temptations. He understands our weaknesses. He understands all of these things. And therefore, the Hebrew writer said, we can come boldly before the throne of grace, that we can find help from God in time of need. And so we hope that you are practicing the praise of God through prayer, and that you are practicing His presence through a very active and continued prayer life. Don't be neglectful of your prayer, because it is the avenue through which we communicate with God and we stay in His presence, and He makes His presence known in our lives. So let's go to God in prayer at this time. Father, we're so thankful to You that we do have this avenue of prayer, that You have invited us to come before You and to offer up our petitions. But Father, we would not just ask You for things that we want or we need, but we hope that we would first of all praise You for all that You've already done in our lives and for us. And above all, what You have done for us in Christ Jesus our Lord. We realize, Father, what a great sacrifice was made on our behalf by Jesus. And may we continually offer up our thanks to You for this, Father. And may our praise before You abound because of the bountiful goodness that You have shown us in Christ Jesus our Lord. Father, my prayer for all of those who listen today is that they would know Your presence in their life through prayer, and that they would use their prayer life for opportunities to praise You and to thank You, and to be reminded of Your presence in our lives, and of the fact that we do have a high priest who is in Your presence, and we can come before You through Him to find the help that we need in time of need. May You hear our petitions, Father, and may You accept our prayers and our thanksgiving to You. Through Christ Jesus our Lord, we pray. Amen. Well, we pray that all is well with you and with your family, and that you are continuing to study God's Word, to stay close to Him by listening to Him in His Word, and that you are staying close to Him by praying to Him and offering up your prayer and thanksgiving to Him. Until we see you again, we pray that God will bless and keep you.
Heaven, I'm going there, glories untold I'll share, all of its beauty will unfold. Inside those pearly gates, Jesus and loved ones wait. This is why I want to go. I'll meet my father and my mother, my sister and my brother, reign through all eternity. But best of all, I'll see my Savior and share His blessed favor. This is why I want to go. River of life that flows, sadness unknown I'm told, all of our burdens He will share. Living and
and basking in sunlight that shines from him. This is why I want to go. I'll meet my father and my mother, my sister and my brother, reign through all eternity. But best of all, I'll see my Savior and share his blessed favor. This is why I want to go. I'll meet my father and my mother, my sister and my brother, reign through all eternity. But best of all, I'll see my Savior and share his blessed favor. This is why I want to go. This is why I want to go. This is why I want to go. This is why I want to go.